The last lecture, and Dr. Frankowski gave one last year, and we are growing a tradition here for last lectures, and I think it's a wonderful tradition, no question about that. It gives the retiring faculty a chance, an opportunity to lecture without having to follow a curriculum. So whatever happens tonight, it's entirely up to Professor Olmsted, that there won't be any other guides, and therefore she's on her own. I want to say a few personal remarks first, and that is Nancy Olmsted is a fine lady, a very, very nice person, and a terrific math teacher. I have that from all reports. I've never taken a math course with her, but every report says she's a magnificent math teacher, and we're going to miss her. Over a few luncheons, she and I have discussed math, teaching, and philosophy in general. And it's been a pleasure each time. And she always comes out on top somehow because she points out something that I know nothing about, which may not be as difficult as some people believe it is. A few years ago for Halloween, Nancy and Ed Griggs dressed up to look like me. They were very successful. In fact, they were so successful, they frightened a lot of people. I know that that Nancy cares very, very deeply about her students, and from the student comments, I know that they understand that as well. They understand a teacher that cares about them, not only a teacher that teaches, but a teacher that cares whether they're learning. And that certainly is Nancy Olmsted. We're going to miss her. She's going to retire to the sunny climes of Maine, which makes you wonder whether she understands the numbering system on the Fahrenheit scale. And I'd like to introduce to you a very good friend and an excellent teacher, Professor Nancy Olmsted.
Thank you all for coming. I really appreciate it. Everybody is supposed to have 15 minutes of fame in their life, and I think I'm having mine right now, and I'm really enjoying it. I'd like to begin by introducing my family who have come here to support me, my husband Wes and my daughter Catherine, my son Eric and his wife Corinne, and my little baby grandson. Yes, hold him up. Everybody needs to see my baby grandson Will. They flew in this morning from Boston to come to the lecture. So it's amazing how far they'll go for some cookies. Wes is a great husband. I have to tell you about him. He does all the cleaning, does the laundry, does the grocery shopping, makes sure that I have a hot meal when I get home at night. So eat your hearts out, ladies. I suppose when I retire, this will all change. I asked some of my colleagues to be here tonight. Some of them have come, and two of them had to go get a stiff drink before they could come, but they're here now. And then my friend Bruce O'Neill, he had a mild heart attack, and I thought that was going to extremes not to have to come to my talk. But he's okay. He's resting comfortably, and he's supposed to be back with us on Monday. Well, when I was first asked to give this lecture, I really panicked. Not that I'm not panicked now, but it was worse then. I attended Roger Frankowski's lecture last year, and it was really terrific. And I thought, I can't follow that. There's no way I can give a lecture as good as that. So then I thought of something my son said when people asked him why he had agreed to go to Iraq. And he said, someone has to go. Why not me? So that's the way I feel about this lecture. Someone has to follow you, Roger. Why not me? So once the decision was made to accept the honor of giving this last lecture, the next problem was, what would I say? So I thought about going to the local public speaking expert, Pat Coffey. But I figured he would just tell me something about you have to be Irish and have the gift of gab. And I'm only Irish on my mother's side, and I've never kissed a Blarney Stone, so that wasn't going to really help. But someone else said, well, talk about something you know. Okay, so I can do that. That's something I know. Now, I thought we could talk about that for about 20 minutes, and then I could give a quiz. But then my students made me promise I wouldn't talk about math. Well, then Nick Seidler had the best idea. He said, just talk about your life experiences. I thought, well, I can do that. Some of them, anyway. Now, Roger had been here 40 years, and I think he talked about 40 minutes. I've been here 18 years, so I figure I've got 18 minutes. But if you'd like to stay a little bit longer, I'm going to give the same speech again in Klingon. Okay, here goes. I was born in a log cabin. No, wait a minute. No, that was Abraham Lincoln. I'm sorry. It was a dark and stormy night when I was born. No, I'm sorry. That was Snoopy. I'll get it in a minute here. I was actually born in a small town in Maine, and I was the youngest of six children. And I was born kind of late after my other brothers and sisters had been born, and they, my five siblings and my parents, they really spoiled me. And they just made sure that everything was very easy for me. So I grew up thinking that everything was always going to be easy. And if something bad happened, I would probably fall apart and not be able to handle it. Well, then something bad did happen. Our oldest son was killed in Iraq, and I didn't fall apart. Through the two army officers coming to our door to give us the news and the military funeral, and every day since then, I have somehow found a strength that I didn't know I had to get on with my life. And I think that this is a strength that everybody has inside them. And you may not know it until something happens that you need that strength. And then you'll dig down and you'll find it's there. Well, I grew up on a farm. And I learned a lot of things that everyone has to learn eventually. If you touch an electric fence while you're standing in a puddle, you'll be sorry. Cows are the world's stubbornest animals, and chickens are the stupidest. And that makes it easy to eat steak and go to KFC. Persistence is essential. If you weed a row of beans and then it rains, you're going to have to go back and weed that row of beans again. Teamwork is important. If a storm is coming, it's going to take the whole crew to get the hay in the barn before it gets wet. Now, these are things that everybody can learn. You don't have to learn them on a farm. I have a friend who grew up in New York City, and he learned them in his father's delicatessen. I have another friend who learned on her family's lobster boat. These are life lessons that we all pick up somewhere along the way. Okay, I learned some lessons on the farm, and now I was ready to go to high school. But in my area, which was kind of a farming area, farm children were expected to drop out of school after the eighth grade. And so there were no buses to carry you on to high school. So the state of Maine allowed me to get my license when I was 15, and I drove back and forth to school in my family's old Studebaker. Anybody remember Studebaker? And I became the most popular kid in the sophomore class because I was the only one who could drive. And I became the person who drove to all the away baseball games, all the away basketball games, all the away football games. And I felt very good about that until my popularity waned as other kids got to be 16 and started driving. I played sports in high school, softball and basketball. No, not real basketball. That was the day when young ladies were too delicate to run up and down the floor and play basketball. So we played basketball six on a side. There were three people were forwards, and they did all the shooting. Three people were guards, and they did all the guarding. You were allowed two dribbles before you had to pass the ball, and you crossed the center line on pain of death. So if I got fouled, as I was a guard, then one of my forwards had to shoot my foul shots. My job was just to get rebounds and throw the ball back to my forwards, and in general be annoying. And some of my colleagues think I'm still pretty annoying. But I don't know why they don't play that way anymore. Really. It was a lot of fun. In the spring, we turned to softball. The equipment that we had for softball consisted of the old baseball equipment given to us when the baseball team got new equipment. I was a catcher, and my catcher's mask had been taped up with duct tape thousands of times to hold it together. My shin guards were so long I tripped over them. And the chest protector was so thin that it just didn't protect much. We weren't allowed to play on the regular baseball field. We played on a gravel parking lot. And since our uniforms consisted of shorts and t-shirts, sliding was never an option. I'd been taught to throw my catcher's mask if I was going for a pop-up fly. So the first time I threw my catcher's mask, my glasses, which I wore at that time, stuck to the duct tape. And they went with the catcher's mask. And I was left looking around nearsightedly to try to find the ball. And I did find it when it dropped on my head. And as it turned out, the only out that inning was me. So what life lessons did I learn in high school? Well, certainly more about teamwork from sports. And if you want to be popular, be the only person who can drive. And duct tape can fix everything. I graduated high school and enrolled in the University of Maine. Now, the University of Maine is a big country campus. And there was such a long distance between the girls' dorm and the women's gym. And I had gym at 8 o'clock in the morning. You needed a dog sled to get from one to the other. And even so, you know, a lot of kids got frostbite. That was the main thing that the infirmary treated in the winter was frostbite. I'm sure that the campus is probably nice in the summer, if there were a summer in Maine. Well, the best thing I got from college is sitting right there. I picked him up in college. I may not have been the smartest kid on campus, but I knew enough to grab that. So, life lessons from college. Protect your nose and your ears in the winter so you don't get frostbite. And this is good for all you students that are sitting in the audience. Okay. Enjoy yourself, because these are the last years that you're going to have where someone isn't expecting you to earn a living. And treasure your friends, because when you graduate, you're going to break up. And you'll be lucky if you see them again. So enjoy them while you're here. Hi, Will. How you doing? You want to come up, huh? You want to say something? He's just making little comments. That's it. Okay, now I had my BA, and I went on and got my MA. And while my husband got his PhD, I got my MOM. Now, this is not really a degree. There's no degree for parenthood. The baby's dropped on your doorstep. And yes, I still believe the baby's dropped on your doorstep by the stalk, all right? Because it's neater that way. And nobody tells you what to do with it. So you get this precious little piece of humanity, like him, and you don't know how you're supposed to take care of it. Well, it's naked, so you put clothes on it. And when it cries, you feed it. But then you're done. If it's still crying, and you've fed it, and you've put clothes on it, then what are you supposed to do? Well, my son faced this problem a little while ago with his baby. And he turned to me and he said, "Mom, what did you do in this situation?" And I wasn't a whole lot of help, because I said, I cried along with the baby and said, "Please be quiet, please be quiet." Well, eventually they do grow up. And you fed them, and they stop crying, and they turn out to be really nice people. So what are the lessons of parenthood? Well, there are quite a few. The first one I think that everyone should learn if they have a boy is, if you're changing his diaper, you lift the diaper, then you put it right back down. Because he's not done. Okay. Now, truly, girls can be just as good at science and math as boys, and vice versa. Discipline is not a dirty word, and children need to hear the word no every once in a while. Schools can teach your children a lot, but it's your job to teach them the most important lessons. You need to teach them discipline, the ability to work hard. It's good to praise your children and raise their confidence, but sometimes you have to explain to them that they can't do everything, and they have to just find the things they can do and then move on. And the most important thing I think I learned in parenthood is it's not possible to love your children too much. Okay. Just take a breath here. Well, my husband got a job in New Jersey. I heard a comedian once talking about New Jersey, and someone was saying to the comedian, you know, the East Coast is sinking slowly? And the comedian said, oh, I hope New Jersey goes first. And I have to admit, I'm sorry if any of you are from New Jersey, but probably you're not, I have to agree with that comedian. New Jersey is just not the best place. They have beautiful beaches, but nothing can make up for that area close to New York. The best thing to come out of New Jersey was my daughter. We adopted her while we were in New Jersey. But you notice we got her out of there very quickly. Life lessons learned in New Jersey. There are terrific Philly cheesesteaks in Trenton. And that's the only thing in Trenton that's terrific. There is a lot of history in New Jersey. The Revolutionary War was actually fought back and forth across New Jersey, which must have been fun for the inhabitants. Think about it. You get up in the morning and you're saying, should I fly the American flag or the British flag? The American flag or the British flag? It was an important decision to make. And then the mosquitoes in New Jersey. They're legend. The mosquitoes in New Jersey are so big, and now you're supposed to say, how big are they?
How big are they?
They are so big, they keep hummingbirds for pets. Well, we escaped New Jersey, and we returned to New England and Massachusetts, and we stayed there for 12 years. Our sons grew up and went to college, and our daughter graduated from high school, and then we heard the call of the Midwest. So it was like Horace Greeley's advice, go Midwest, young man, go Midwest. We moved out here and settled in Wisconsin, and we've been here for a very happy 20 years. All right, now I have to tell you about my cat. We have a cat against my will. Growing up on a farm, being stepped on by horses, slapped in the face with dirty cow tails, pecked at by hens that didn't want to give up their eggs, and just smelling pigs. You have no desire to have pets. But kids love pets. So we had our share of cats and hamsters and more cats and smaller hamsters. Well, my daughter decided, she was living with us, and she decided she wanted to have a cat. And I held out against this as long as I could, but finally, in a weak moment, I said, okay. So she and her father went over and got a cat and brought it home. The cat immediately demonstrated his dominance by shredding the arms of the couch. Now, being responsible pet owners, we had him fixed. He's never forgiven us. He's an indoor cat, and he likes to look out the window in the family room, and it looks out onto our deck. And from time to time, a female cat will come up on the deck and, you know, just kind of sashay across in front of the window. And he looks out, and I can see him thinking, I should be interested in that, but I can't remember why. He kept jumping up on the counter. Couldn't get him to stop. We wanted to break him of that, so covered the counter with plastic wrap. Next time he jumped up, his momentum took him down to the end of the counter, made a right turn at the sink, went off the end, landed on the floor on his feet, looked up at me and said, I meant to do that. But it did keep him off the counter. Now, eventually, my daughter moved out. And she said, I can't take the cat. I'm in an apartment. Can't take the cat. So the cat became ours. And I said to my husband, aha! Which my husband knows mean, I told you so, I told you so, I told you so. So we have the cat. I feed the cat. I give the cat water. I clean the litter box. And every night, the cat sits in my husband's lap and purrs. But if I should get up and start down the cellar stairs where his food box is, he will be under my feet, and suddenly he's my BFF. Lessons from the cat. Never pass up a chance to take a nap. Now, as I get older, I appreciate that more and more. Despite what your mother said, it is fun to play with your food. Plastic wrap is not your friend. And then the old standby, dogs drool, cats rule. I've always enjoyed my time at MSOE. First couple of years, I took part in the mentor program. I like to work at Math Counts and the Science Bowl. I helped the Red Army during the St. Patrick's Day festivities. As Dr. Veets mentioned, I once dressed up as Dr. Veets on Halloween, and they would still not give me his check. If they had, I might have been able to retire sooner. And then I made one mistake. One spring fling, I agreed to be in the dunk tank. It was a cool, cloudy spring day, and I was scheduled for the 4 o'clock shift. The fraternity men in charge, feeling that the water would not be cold enough, went to the Metromark and bought bags of ice and put them into the water in the dunk tank. By 4 o'clock, it was all melted, and the water was like minus 152 degrees. So I got up on my little seat, and it was a little seat. I'm telling you, it was no bigger than this. You know, a little tiny seat. Perched up there and waited, hoping that maybe nobody would hit the target. Well, the first student hit the target, and I went down into the water, and it was so cold, my brain froze. And I just bobbed up and down under the water, thinking, I know I should do something, because this is really going to look bad in the paper if they have to report that an instructor at MSOE drowned in the dunk tank. So I got my feet under me, and I got out of the water, breathed again, got back up on my little perch, thinking, well, the first one hit it, but surely there'll be no other sure shots hitting it. They all hit it. I think they brought in ringers from baseball teams or something. They all hit the target, and every time I went into the dunk tank. Well, the next year, the same fraternity said, would you like to be in the dunk tank again this year? We're not going to put any ice in it this year. Ha! Once bitten, twice shy. No more dunk tank. I've seen many changes here at MSOE. When I came, the C building was still the campus eyesore. Fortunately, we've gotten rid of that right now. I watched the construction of the Kern Center and the Federal Bank building being made into the Grohmann Museum. The Humphrey House was just an empty building until they gutted it and made it into the president's residency. The Veets used to live on Lakeshore Drive, which I know was a long drive for the president to come to work every day. I think they were happy to move on campus. And now Dr. Veets' idea of a bad commute is when the walk light on Broadway is against him. The second floor of this building was the bank, and the lobby down, the commuters lounge downstairs was the lobby of the bank at that time. And now the second floor houses the new biomolecular department, and soon I think to house some chemistry labs and maybe some offices, which will be nice. And also very exciting, we will soon have a new soccer field under which there will be a garage. So I figure in 5 years when I come back, I won't even recognize the place. When the Grohmann Museum opened, we in the math department lost our general studies neighbors. They had shared a hall with us for many years, and we were used to hearing poetry and foreign languages down the hall from us. They moved their offices to the museum, and now the computer science and software engineering people share the hall with us. We don't hear very much poetry, but there's still a foreign languages. C++ is one. Lessons learned at MSOE. Don't ever volunteer to be in the dunk tank. You're never too old to learn, and the students have a lot to teach. If you have a problem with your laptop or your cell phone or your BlackBerry or your Blueberry or your Strawberry or any of those electronic gadgets, just ask a student. And they'll know. They'll know exactly how to fix it. Youth is not wasted on the young. They're just the only ones that have enough stamina to survive it. And age does not necessarily bring wisdom, but at least it gives you the patience to start looking for wisdom. Okay, I'm going to be a little serious here for a moment. About 30 years ago, I was diagnosed with manic depression, which is now called bipolar disorder. I like the term manic depression myself because it describes the malady better. If I don't take my medication, I can go between dangerous highs and deep, deep depressions. But I do take my medication, and it allows me to be almost normal. And most of the people who know me probably don't even know that I have manic depression until now. When I was first diagnosed, I was ashamed of being mentally ill. But over the years, I've realized that my illness is caused by a brain chemistry imbalance, and it's no different really than having diabetes or any other physical illness. Some people are still ashamed that they might be mentally ill, and that's why they don't always seek treatment. We have students here at MSOE who are being treated, and that's good. We have other students here who are ignoring the problem and hoping it will go away. And trust me, it doesn't go away. So if you know anybody who suffers from bipolar, anxiety, clinical depression, paranoia, schizophrenia, encourage them to get help. Because all of these diseases are treatable, and they are also life-threatening because of the high incidence of suicide. So you could change a person's life. In fact, you could save a person's life. Okay, that's it, it's over. I love teaching, especially at MSOE. For 18 years, I have loved coming to work. My students are a joy, and my colleagues are my friends. Here's my advice to you. Find a job that you like. Maybe it will be being an engineer. Maybe it will be being a nurse or a business person. Maybe it will be being an electrician or a plumber. Maybe it will even be being a university president. But the important thing is that you want to be happy when you go to work every day. Being in a job that you hate can affect your whole attitude about everything. So look around, even if you have to change jobs several times, look around until you find something that you're happy with, it gratifies you, and it makes you content. Because in the long run, contentment is even more important than happiness. Now, since I love my job and have enjoyed living in Wisconsin, you may be wondering why we're choosing to move halfway across the country to Maine, apart from the warmer climate, of course. There are two major reasons, and the first one is this. Let me tell you about every term we teachers have our students make out these evaluation forms to tell us what they think of our teaching. About 5 years after I came here, a student wrote, "I like Mrs. Olmsted. She reminds me of my mother." I thought that was nice. 10 years later, another student wrote, "I like Mrs. Olmsted. She reminds me of my grandmother." And last term, a student wrote, "I like Mrs. Olmsted. She reminds me of my great-grandmother." Now, when you get that comment, it's time to leave. And the second more important reason is sitting right over there. William Andrew Olmsted, our first and only grandchild so far. And if you can't see him, well, just ask me to show you a picture. Okay, well, they live in Boston, and we're tired of plane rides from here to Boston. And they may be tired of plane rides out here. So we're going to go back closer, so that instead of getting on a plane every time we want to go to one of his birthdays or Christmas, we can just drive. We're going to Maine to live in a very small town on the coast called Stockton Springs. It's so small that it doesn't have a McDonald's. Heck, it doesn't even have a Starbucks. But we figure that we're going to need some money to go along with our Social Security, because I'm sure all of you know that Social Security is small. So we've hit on a plan. We're going to have a well at our house. We're going to bottle the well water in really, really nice looking cut glass decanters and sell it as Stockton Springs water. And I figure in a few years we'll outsell Poland Springs and we'll be rich as Warren Buffett. And you can all say you knew me when. Let me share with you what it means to be from Maine. If you only recognize two seasons, winter and getting ready for winter, you're from Maine. Or actually, you could be from Wisconsin. If you ride a horse, you're from Maine. If you eat lobster and clam chowder, you're from Maine. If you can say "aya" with a straight face, you're from Maine. If every pickup truck you see has a plow in the front and a rifle in the back window, you're from Maine. And if you think Milwaukee is a huge city, you're from Maine. But if you teach or go to school at a small Midwestern college that produces top-notch engineers, nurses, and business people, and has a first-class museum in the middle of campus, then you're from Milwaukee School of Engineering. And that's a great place to be from. Thank you.
commemorate the occasion, we have for you to hang on your wall. And I think we also have a videotape.
Oh, thank you.
So I think you'll like that perhaps even better. Thank you very much. Professor Olmsted.
Maybe in a few more months we'll have a wall to put this on. Did you want to ask any questions?
When do you sat in Klingon?
I couldn't decide whether to do it in conversational Klingon or battle Klingon, so. Yes, sir.
Professor, how do you spell Delter?
How do we spell what?
Delter.
Delter?
D-E-L-T-E-R.
Really, Professor Griggs, I'm surprised at your age you can't do that. Anyone else? Good, okay. Let's all go eat or something. Have some cookies.